Okay, well, I can't say whether something I said has obviously cleared the room, but I do understand that people have trains to catch. The first question I always have to ask is, can you hear me at the back? Right. If you happen to be feeling a bit bored and you're playing your iPads while you're listening, and you feel like you're doing a search on Google on police accountability, you will find that means lots of different things. It could mean the ability to fire the Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police, for example. It might mean the decision to challenge some police wanting to stop patrols down your local street. Quite commonly, it's some sort of academic or political treatise on institutions or structures. But actually, very commonly, it's an expression of the feeling that police officers who do bad things or who are in charge when bad things happen should in some way be punished for them. Now, accountability is, of course, not only about punishment for misconduct. The police must also be accountable for a key role in protecting the public, in deterring and detecting crime, and of course, in the use of public money. The accountability for all of those things is shared by a number of bodies. Now, I hope nobody minds very much if I don't spend a great deal of time on police and crime commissions today. I hope nobody will be very disappointed if I don't spend too much time on that. Because what I want to do today is focus on that part of police accountability that involves the Independent Police Complaints Commission. Now, what we do know is that police accountability in the 21st century, is actually very different from what's gone before. But what is always important about these things is when we're looking at the present and the future, is actually look where we've come from. So what I want to do is spend a bit of time looking at some context and looking at the past. Now, some of you will be aware of this, but in the beginning, there was nothing. So from the establishment of the Metropolitan Police by Sir Robert Peel in 1829, all the way through until the creation of the Police Complaints Board in 1977, there was no mechanism for independent oversight in any form. Accountability started and finished with the Home Secretary of the day. So that was nearly 150 years on which I suspect quite a few police officers today look back with considerable nostalgia. But oversight mechanisms never come out of thin air, nor indeed out of the random thoughts of politicians. They invariably have their roots in some sort of public scandal. And then politicians feel obliged to respond, which of course is the familiar refrain that you will hear all the time, something must be done. So what are the origins of accountability, oversight in the 20th century? Well, the Police Complaints Board had its origins in the police corruption scandals of the 1970s, particularly in the Met. But what must be granted as the most token, in my view, of political responses, it was given virtually no powers. It could just scrutinize the police report. So let's fast forward to 1985. And the creation, following the Brixton riots, of the Police Complaints Authority. This didn't fare much better on powers. It could only supervise a police investigation. Again, in my view, a fine example of the government of the day paying lip service to the need for independent oversight without actually giving the body charged with the responsibility the tools to do the job. So we come to the McPherson Inquiry, and then 2004, and the replacement of the PCA by the Independent Police Complaints Commission, which for the first time in the history of England and Wales actually has the power to investigate cases involving the police. Our investigators have, and they use, police powers when carrying out criminal investigations. We can arrest and search, we can use intrusive surveillance. So while there are gaps in our powers that we're seeking to fill, we do remain one of the most powerful police oversight bodies in the world. Now, I have to say, there isn't much of a boast, because governments traditionally everywhere are much closer to the pre-IPCC model. generally are reluctant to burden their own law enforcement arm with too much oversight. So there's just a small problem of resources for the IPCC. And actually, if you go back to the parliamentary debates, take a look at Hansard in 2002, and you will see ministers talking about the IPCC doing 1,000 independent investigations in its first year. But when the time came for writing out the checks, we got enough money to do 30. So although 8 years on, we now do about 130, that still leaves a vast gap in public expectations. And it's not unreasonable that people think that a body called the Independent Police Complaints Commission actually carries out independent investigations into complaints, of which there are about 30,000 a year. So what we're set up for, and what we actually do, is investigate the most serious cases involving the police. And what I'd like to do is take a look at a few of those over the years, during which the image of British policing has, it's fair to say, had taken a bit of a battering. Although those with long memories may well say it was ever thus. I think the case most people remember of recent times is the shooting of John Charles Menzies at Stockport Tube Station in 2005. Or the G20 demonstrations in 2009 and the death of Ian Tomlinson. And the theme that year was police handling and public protest. And what you might remember is how the images of the benign British OBE were replaced by perceived police brutality. You get clips posted on the internet that, you know, they get broadcast around news channels across the globe. So we move on to 2010, and what we find is that the major theme was the Police Failure to Act. So it's not their direct actions. But in this case, in particular, their response to victims of sexual violence. Failures in rape cases, the war boys and Reed, failure to catch serial sex offenders, failures in the response to domestic violence. So these cases presented a worrying pattern of a police that was neither a service nor much of a force when it was needed. 2011, the dominant theme there, that's a pretty obvious one, and I say this on the day that the Leveson Inquiry report comes out. Clearly, the theme of last year was allegations of corrupt relations between the police and the media. So while there's still a month to go in 2012, and the scandals seem to pop up these days faster than Usain Bolt out of the books, the defining case of 2012 is very likely to be Hillsborough, even though it's 23 years old. And throughout the past few years, we've also seen growing numbers of allegations against the most senior officers, including chief constables. And whether they're proven or not, they are very damaging to public confidence. So all of these cases have been, or some of them are still, the subject of IPCC investigations. Some have been aired in inquests, criminal courts, or both. Officers have been charged, convicted, acquitted, dismissed, or subject to performance measures. Numerous recommendations have been made for improvements in operational policing. And still the headlines continue. Have things got worse, or does the public simply know more? I want to reflect for a moment on the impact of social media and new technology, because it's a critical component of police accountability today. Now, I'm giving away my age here, but when I first started in an office job, I had to ask people what a fax was. Now, I've now got a mobile phone, I've actually got a BlackBerry, but none of us can anticipate how technology is actually going to change and the way we do things in the second, you know, really in the first half of the 21st century. Let's just think for a moment about the crucial evidence of a bystander at the G20 protests in 2009. That was captured on video, and it was instrumental to the prosecution for manslaughter of PC Simon Harwood, who was eventually acquitted after a jury deliberated for quite a few days. And he was subsequently dismissed in only the second misconduct hearing in public, directed by the IPCC. Now there's a bit of an irony there, because actually the footage became public before it was given to us, or the police. And because of the huge growth in CCTV, the myth still persists that the police must have known what was going on, and but for this video would have covered it up. In fact, we've got thousands of hours of footage to prove this. CCTV cameras on the crucial spot were either they weren't working, or they're operating inside shops, they'd be boarded up, so all they showed was wood because of the protests. So while we should be immensely grateful to the bystander for helping to hold the police to account, we shouldn't actually, in this case, blame police leaders for not knowing what the public knew before they did. I'm going to give you another G20 example because, in the case you might recall, two baton strikes on a young female protester by a large male police officer, also captured on a photo at G20. Remember that one? Once again, the footage found its way over the internet and from there into the media. We took that on as an independent investigation. We interviewed the officer under criminal caution, and the CBS decided to charge him with assault. During the trial, the complainant declined to give evidence, and the officer was acquitted. But a wide circulation of that footage and the officer's subsequent prosecution and acquittal absolutely polarized public opinion. And I'd like to quote for you from a few of the blog comments after the verdict. This guy was doing his job, and this case should not even have gone to court. Blog number one. The girl may have been gobby, but after having seen a clip of the assault, I cannot believe this guy got off. It looked like sheer thuggery to me. Okay? I won't ask, and I could do a poll here as to which of these, you know, camps you're in, you know. Do we have a camp number one here? Just doing his job? Sheer thuggery? I think we have a lot of people on the fence. Well, let me give you number three. What people are forgetting is that they've only seen a 30-second video of the situation. Okay, so it looked wrong what the officer did, but I don't see many, if at all, any armchair critics willing to do that job. Now, that is actually, but these are actual blog comments from that case, after people. And actually, what they do demonstrate actually is how you will not get a uniform view of the public around what you see, but also, is what you see really what you get? You filter that through what actually happened in the court case. There's lots of examples like that, and it is indeed the case that many people will judge police action on the basis of a few seconds of footage, which may not show the incident in context, and the sheer number of cameras everywhere does present a unique 21st century challenge. On the one hand, you've got the public with their cameras making the police more accountable. On the other, it can lead to snap judgments based on limited information. But as is often said, Britain has a long tradition of policing by consent. The British police are not routinely armed, and most, if not, rarely draw their batons. The model by which police are trained to use force emphasizes something called tactical communications, which to you and me, non-police officers, actually means talking to people, where possible before force is used. The vast majority of police are not corrupt, and while there are rude and lazy officers, as there are in fact sadly everywhere in life, and in fact every branch of public service, most do a decent job in challenging and often thankless circumstances, and some do an outstanding job in the public interest. Now these of course aren't the cases that get the headlines and they don't get referred to us. But police officers need to know that although they have special powers, they will be held to account by the same criminal law as anyone else. So an allegation service via mobile phones or other media, loosely called citizen journalism, it can sometimes be the IPCC's job to do the professional investigation that provides the full picture. But this takes time and it takes painstaking effort, and that just doesn't sit well with the 24-hour news cycle and demands of the media. And sometimes even when a case is being fully exposed to the rigors of a criminal trial, nobody's happy with the outcome. So how do you get informed consent, for example, to the way the police use force? Well, it would help if the police started talking in a language people understand. Let's consider the term distraction verb. I know there are a few police officers in the audience who know what a distraction verb is. And to the police here, it's a tactic to gain compliance. Actually, to the person walking past on the street seeing a distraction blow, it's the police hitting someone. You may not actually be fighting back. explain to the public how they do their jobs. And if people can't accept it, they also need to reflect on whether that tactic is actually right. And let's move on also about the current sector and public sector, you know, in the climate of public sector cuts. They've also got to explain that if you're cutting, there are things that you won't be able to do anymore. There are issues around resources and priorities. You need to bring people with you. So all too often in cases like the police response to things, when you're dealing with a failure to respond, you know, often this is around, well, you just aren't enough people to do the job and something has to give. Well, have you got that balance right? And the image of police accountability is also not helped by the lack of openness in the current police misconduct system. It's mostly dealt with behind closed doors, and I don't think that is conducive to public confidence. Now, the IPCC has the power to direct the police to hold a hearing in public. We've only used this twice, though we have consulted actually a number of other cases. And actually, that's the problem. It can only be applied to a few cases, because there must be independent investigations. And the effect of the current law is basically that there must be some exceptional public interest to overcome the presumption of privacy that applies to these proceedings. Now, why shouldn't this presumption be reversed? So that hearings were in public unless there was a good reason not to. Now, I made some inquiries with the Metropolitan Police just earlier today. How many officers have they dismissed just this year? Just involve our cases. Some of them are, some of them aren't. Between January and the beginning of November this year, the Metropolitan Police dismissed 45 police officers. All people held to account for some misdeed. How many of you, how many in London, is that it can be hard to take public criticism. We've got lots of experience of this ourselves because we do get it on a regular basis. Can be hard to take, and particularly when it's not fair. But the response of the police all too often is to crawl into a bunker. Even if the reporting isn't fair, and I've seen a lot of it, there was a lot of it around G20, that doesn't always mean the police didn't get it wrong. The better response is to listen, learn, to respond. That's something that we ourselves do. For example, in the work we're doing about, you know, can we do things better dealing with deaths following police contact? But the police still have all too often a cultural reluctance to apologize when they get things wrong. There are so many times when I've looked at lengthy investigations that have gone on months and years after the event, nobody's happy with the outcome, and I thought, why on earth didn't they just say sorry straight away? It really does seem to be the hardest word. So are the police accountable in the 21st century? Well, compared to that historical context, the answer has to be yes. Although not always, and not always with outcomes that people want. Accountability isn't and should not be synonymous with punishment. In the case of the most senior officers, for example, when something has gone wrong on their watch, and I think it's on the crime scene, accountability is taking responsibility for putting things right. So once again, we're seeing a change in the system. Just last week, police authorities were replaced by police and crime commissioners. Today, accountability is variously shared between the IPCC, chief officers, HMIC, ministers, and now PCCs, with a new College of Policing also having a standard-setting role. So looking to the past helps us understand how we've arrived at today. But the police themselves, and this will be a real challenge for the new police and crime commissioners, need to do more themselves to demonstrate their accountability. The IPCC was not established to investigate all complaints, most of which will be investigated or resolved in some way by the police themselves. Something that people actually aren't all aware of is that last week, when the law changed in relation to appeals about police complaints, which no longer will all go to the IPCC. So chief officers will have an even bigger job to do to ensure that they respond to legitimate grievances in ways that improve rather than diminish public confidence. time to police audiences, think of complaints as feedback. You know, think of it as the public actually helping you do a better job. You know, not a nuisance in the box you've got to tick and send off to some department somewhere else who's going to deal with it. Apologize where appropriate, explain where necessary, demonstrate that you've learned from your mistakes, and above all, engage. Individual officers also need to do more, sometimes, to demonstrate that they are truly accountable. Now, there's an expectation that officers will provide a rationale for their decisions and actions when questioned. And that's whether by the IPCC or anyone else investigating them, or before a coroner or a criminal court. But there are also public servants who should assist an investigation whether or not they are suspects. And all too often these days, they do not. They give us written statements, but they decline to be interviewed. And I think actually officers who do that need to reflect as public servants on how this impacts on public confidence. We don't yet have the power to compel police officers to attend the interview as witnesses, and it is a poor reflection on the police that we need to ask for it. But I hope this is a power that's being remedied even as I speak. Accountability was at the heart of Sir Robert Peel's principles of 1829, when he said the ability of the police to perform their duties is dependent on public approval of their existence, actions, and behavior. Technology and oversight mechanisms have moved on hugely, but the principle hasn't. We may have come a long way in 200 years on the march to police accountability, but not quite there yet. Thank you very much, and I'm very happy to take your questions if there's time to do so.
Thank you.